time is up, I call the meeting to order. This is the meeting of the Constitutional Affairs Panel. Please invite the administration to join us. Item 1, list of outstanding items, the information papers issued since the last meeting. We haven't got any under this item. Item 2, items for discussion at the next meeting. I would like to wait for the administration to join us first. I'd like to welcome Mr. Tam, the Secretary for Constitutional and Mainland Affairs, as well as his team. We have got Mr. Ronald Chen, Undersecretary, Mr. Gordon Leung, Deputy Secretary, Mr. Lee Pak Hong from the Registration and Electoral Office, Mr. Shum, also from the REO, and as well as Mr. Ryan Chu, PAS. Mr. Tam, our next meeting will be held on the 18th of January at 2:30 p.m. in 2016. You would like to propose two items, right? Indeed, Mr. Chairman. We would like to propose two items. First of all, a briefing on the policy address by the CE for 2016. As usual, we'll give you a briefing and then we will listen to members' views. We'd like to have it done for the next regular meeting. In addition, the Election Committee Subsector Election 2016, as well as a review of the election expenses limit for the 2017 CE election. They will be held towards the end of 2016 as well as the first quarter of 2017 respectively. We would like to review the election expenses limits. So at the next meeting, we would like to listen to your views. All right, if there aren't any other comments, we'll have those two items. Item 3, enhancement of voter registration system. Two papers have been given to members, one from the administration, CB(2466/15-16)-03. As to the other paper, (04), is a background brief from the Secretariat. I would like to give the floor to Mr. Tam, the Secretary, and then we can ask questions after the briefing. Thank you. I'm sure members will recall that on the 30th of September, in response to your proposal, we attended your special meeting at which we talked about various issues concerning voter registration. At that time, members were concerned about the voter registration system, the various issues related to that, as well as our initial proposals to enhance the system. In the light of the views expressed at that meeting, we have also issued a paper, consultation document on enhancement of voter registration system. It was issued in November 2015, a copy of which has been given to members on the 26th of November. Currently, we're in the process of collecting comments from the society in relation to the directions of our review. It will end by the 8th of January next year in relation to the consultation exercise. We have talked about the penalties, the checking, and also the review to hear claims and objections, deadlines, whether there's a need to provide address proof. We have come up with a number of proposed measures. I'm sure you have all got a copy of the consultation document. The details have been set out, like factors that we have taken into account as well as the details. So I don't propose to go into the details. In a moment, we're going to listen to members and we'll be very happy to listen to your views. If you've got further questions, myself and my colleagues in the Bureau, as well as Mr. Lee and other members from the RUO, will be happy to take questions from you. All right, thank you. So far, five members would like to ask questions. They've raised their hands. Let me check if other members would also like to ask questions. Then it's Kwok Wong Kwok, Heng Sit Ho, Emily Lau, Yip Kin Jun, in that order. Anybody else? Yes, Sterry Lee, Mr. Yip Kwok Kim. Well, first of all, let me give you 4 minutes each. Dennis Kwok. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I would like to ask a question concerning the consultation document. Mention is made about the address proof. I think you are making this proposal so as to reduce the risk of vote rigging and also to confirm that should there be a change of residential address, you would like to have an address proof. I do agree with such a direction, but assuming that somebody is homeless, do you have any special procedures to make sure that a homeless person would not be rendered unregisterable? Secretary, when we make the proposal in relation to address proof, we did take into account vote rigging or a malicious attempt to change the address of voters. In our paper for consultation, there is a footnote. If you turn to footnote 11, well, the REO will accept the following as address proofs, like race, water, electricity, gas bills, letters issued by banks, government departments, schools, or institutions, failing which, then we can have a second option, that is somebody residing with the elector concerned may sign a declaration to declare that this is a person residing together with the elector, or a statutory declaration can be made before a commissioner for oath or a purchasing society or JP, and free statutory declaration services are provided by the district officers. In fact, our district officers can also be a person who can receive a statutory declaration. If there are proposals for other ways to deal with the issue of address proofs, we're happy to listen to your views. For the homeless persons, we're happy to ask for the help of NGOs to arrange for the registration of homeless electors. Our information shows that we have got a number of homeless persons who have been registered via the various channels I've mentioned. Say, for example, we have got a registered social worker, and he's satisfied that a person is homeless, so this will be considered, right? And another question is that I may be residing in a particular unit. Is there a way for me to find out whether other electors have also used my address as the registration address? Say, Kenneth Chen is found to have registered my address, but in fact he doesn't reside with me. Yes, I understand your point. Mr. Lee can supplement. When we published the provisional register as well as the final register, we started the practice a few years ago. We do arrange the details in accordance with the residential addresses so that you can check who has used your address to register. Mr. Lee, we will not make a particular effort to check how many people have been using the same address for registration. But then we do watch out for multiple names for a single address or multiple surnames. For the homeless, if a registered social worker is willing to provide supplementary information to satisfy us that he is indeed a homeless person, we'll be happy to register him. All right, thank you. Next, Mr. Wong Kwok Heng. Through you, Chair, I would like to ask the Secretary. for the objection system. I think there is something wrong with the objection mechanism. For the FTU, not too long ago, there was a district councillor belonging to the FTU, and then the address was changed by somebody else, and then the REO would like to ask for address proof or other evidence, but it was difficult for our FTU member to prove that. So I would say that this is a very serious loophole. For the FTU DC member as well as candidates from the FTU wishing to take part in the DC election, they quickly try to verify whether their addresses have been changed without their knowing, and therefore they would be disqualified. Because it could have been possible, my question is, if somebody would like to deregister a particular elector, or if somebody would like to change the residential address of a particular elector, I'm afraid you didn't take the job seriously. Otherwise, what I said would not have happened. So what are you going to do to plug the loophole? And for the objection mechanism that you've got in place, how can you make sure that what I've referred to will not happen again? SCMA. In a moment, Mr. Lee can add to what I am going to say in relation to the specific cases. For the proposals that we are making on this occasion, well, a number of points cover the concern raised by Mr. Wong. Say, for example, for the two deadlines, we would like to align them so that when we issue or when we publish the register, it will be clear to everybody as to whether a person's particulars have been changed by others. So, of course, we have also got a website, and of course, in the next item, we will devote more space to that. We are going to publicize that website so that 365 days around the year, you can visit the website to check this status.
Also, in 2 to 3 places in the document, we have talked about the mechanism and the objection mechanism, and also there will have to be a balance struck for the objector and the person objected to. There will be a balance. Mr. Lee, any supplement? Yes. Mr. Wong Kwok Heng made a point concerning where the voter is asked to provide information or evidence concerning any unlawful change of address, then usually we would ask this person to come up to our office to see whether the application form was indeed not signed by this person. Now, this is serious. This is actually a criminal act if anybody assumes another person's name or signs as that person, an imposter. And we would ask the voter to rectify the address in the voter register, and the person will not need to provide any further evidence except to just say that the signature is not his. Now, I would like to ask you, you mentioned just now that the person will have to appear in person in your office for providing the evidence or to provide proof. When did you start with that practice? Well, in the last cycle, when we found that there were these cases, we have been talking to the Legal Affairs Department and as to how we should handle these cases. And this is, in fact, a criminal offense. So we will ask the affected voter to come up to our office to evidence or to say that the signature is not his. So we have started that practice in the last cycle. We will continue to do so if there should be any such changes of address cases. Follow-up point, Mr. Chair, concerning C10 constituency, there in Siusai Wan, there are over 200 such voters. In 2010, they have voted as well, and these are public housing estates voters. Very rarely do they change their address unless they have been moving out. However, their qualifications, over 200 of such voters, have been cancelled their qualifications, and there have been no notifications to these people whatsoever. That is very strange indeed. How will you resolve this? Mr. Chair, I do not know about the details of this case, but if we should cancel the qualifications of a voter, there will have to be a procedure. We will send the person by mail a notification. I suspect for these 200 voters, for whatever reason, their addresses have not been renewed, and therefore they have not received the notification from the office. I will have to look into the details of this case. As for the existing procedure, they will have to re-register as voters. Ms. Sit Ho, thank you, Chair. Actually, for voters registration, it should really be made convenient for the people of Hong Kong so that they are more eager to register as voters. But in the past period of time, because of a number of foul practices, such as unlawful changes of address and rigging of votes, etc., we have to go through this process, and we are therefore in support of this proposal. Now, I'm looking at the footnote. There are three items there. First of all, that a reliable organization issues residence or address proof, such as bank, the town gas, etc. Now, for the bank, if a person wants to open an account with an address wherein he does not reside, he can well do so. How do you resolve that? And B, for someone who claims that he resides with this person, and if this person can make a statement, that would also do. However, because with this kind of phone rigging, the person does not know that the address had been used. Now, if whoever wants to perpetrate this practice moves a few people, quote-unquote, into the same residence and they make that claim, then that would qualify as well under this criterion. So how do you resolve that? So what the crux of the issue is your ability in verifying these cases, in looking into these cases. If you do not have the manpower as the gatekeeper and you fail in the first gatekeeping exercise, and also for addresses moving to what, 9th floor, block C, etc., you do not have people to go on site for investigation, and you fail in this first gatekeeping function, what do we do? I mean, shouldn't you have more resources and people to look into these cases so that there is less vote rigging? And also for public housing estates, in the past, if you lend your address to a party to so-called move more parties into your unit, it is problematic. But it seems that there is a new scenario whereby people have been, quote-unquote, moved out of certain units. So these affected units and these affected persons, will this not adversely affect their right to continue to reside in these units? Have you looked into that? Mr. Chair, looking into the questions as outlined by Ms. Sit Ho, it is not one-pronged in terms of resolution. For example, whether there is any collusion in reporting a false address. For this kind of cases, we are raising it from level 2 to level 3. And the penalties would be a lot higher as a result, from the existing 5,000 and incarceration of 6 months, raised to $10,000 and incarceration or imprisonment for 2 years. And that is only 1 point. And note 11 there, in the past few years, we say that during the investigation for evidence of address, we have already mentioned what our office would accept as proof. And you can also see that we are very realistic. Some people, some young people, live with their parents when they do not have independent utilities proof of address, and the school evidence would suffice, or the parents can also make a claim to say, yes, the child still resides with them. All these are admissible as well. And as mentioned just now, for any false information provided, as mentioned, we are raising the penalties, and also we ask for other sources of proof for residents in order to plug the loopholes. Now, as for resources, we will be talking about in the next agenda item in the 2016 round of voters registration in terms of allocation of resources, what the situation will be. Mr. Lee will be talking about that later. What about Housing Department? Follow-up, Mr. Lee? Concerning the cases outlined by Ms. Ho, our preliminary understanding is that it does not have to do with whether the person is living in housing department estates. For the cases, indeed, the person had been living in public housing estates. Because the police is still investigating the cases, I don't want to go into the details, but it is not about the housing department's register or information whether it is correct, but rather whether there had been anyone using false means or procedures to change the voter's address. Emily Lau. The Democratic Department, party, is very concerned about this, using false addresses. So we are basically in support of providing address evidence. And we are also in support of raising the penalties. $10,000 is not sufficient, because the penalty has to be hefty enough to send a strong message to society that it has to be effective in its preventive effect. And also, there will have to be investigative exercise and resources to look into the cases. Now, some party members say 100% investigation into any alleged cases. But of course, you will need more resources in order to restore the confidence of the people in the system, because the confidence is being wrecked as we speak. Now, there's another point I do not understand. What do you mean by putting all the names and objectors onto the website? I mean, the ICAC, for instance, if a person lodges a case or complaint at the ICAC, would they do that? Are you providing unnecessary pressure on the objectors? And also, you say they have the responsibility of providing evidence. Now, if there is a citizen who feels that next door unit, there are over, 14 people registering the unit as the address. What does a person do? Do you knock on the door and come up with evidence? I mean, you will not be able to get into the block. I mean, what do you mean by providing evidence? Are you encouraging people? Yes, reasonable suspicion, I can understand that, but providing evidence, what do you mean by that? Only you people will have the right to access a block and do investigations. How can other people do that? And if they can't do that, then you say, oh, that's an abuse of the objection mechanism. If it were indeed abuse, then it would be uncovered at the court. So do not make people or discourage people from making objections or coming up with reporting cases, please. Mr. Tam. Mr. Chair, for the entire procedure, there are three parts to it, to the objection mechanism, the raising of objection, the investigation, and also the response. I would broadly describe it as that. Now, for raising evidence, the person raising the case will have to at least describe the concern points. For example, Ms. Emily Lau said that next door there should be four people staying there, residing in that unit, and then all of a sudden it becomes 40 in the voters' registration. And that is already prima facie evidence for raising a case. And let's say this building has only 25 floors, and in the voters' register, it says 27th floor. So that is another piece of information that is sufficient for raising a case. Now, apart from that, verification of the evidence is another process in the procedure. According to the objection cases raised, there will be obtaining the information concerning the registered voter, the residence, and basically the electoral office will be taking care of that, the REO. And also the officer, in looking into the case, the objector can either appear in person in court or provide evidence, or the person objected against, that is a so-called register voter, will provide the evidence. Mr. Chair, is that the same as the present procedures? Now, in terms of investigation of evidence and in terms of responding to the evidence, that is, we already have procedures. As for providing evidence, we feel, as we said in the paper, that those providing the evidence, there should be more information. What more information, please? Well, as I mentioned just now, at least there should be some reasonable reasons for making the objections, and also further information such as providing the objection letter. The person will have to provide more information or reasons for making the objection rather than to say, oh, I am suspicious and I would just lodge an objection. Can Mr. Lee supplement? He's more familiar with this mechanism. Mr. Chair, perhaps if I can supplement some information from real cases. In 2015, the REO was to help the adjudicator, the judge, as to whether these cases are worthy of further action. For example, taking out these voters or changing the information. Now, the REO's role is very important because we would want to provide to the court relevant and reliable information. And in verification of evidence, if we can know the reason for the objector in raising the objection, then in our verification and investigation, it will be more specific. We will have more to work on. For example, the floor doesn't even exist in this building. That's easy because that would be straightforward. Or if the objector says the unit is uninhabited, or the family living next door does not consist of a person with such and such a surname. But we also have found that for some of the cases, the objector had not provided specific evidence in his objection. And it becomes difficult in the investigative process because we didn't know where to start the investigation. So the objector might have to provide more specific information so that the court can have more information to make a decision. And the objector, I'm sure, should have this responsibility under the law. He cannot just say, oh, I suspect this person doesn't live or reside in that unit. I just don't believe that that is the case. And that seems to be a subjective judgment without any objective or reasonable basis. But I'm not saying all cases of objection are like that, but there are such cases. And so the magistrate had found it difficult.
The next member, Mr. Yip Kin Yun. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Now, we are talking about the voter registration system. It is important. For voter registration, on the one hand, we would like to facilitate more electors to get registered so that we can enhance the registration rate. On the other hand, we have to take into account the reliability of the registration system. Want to know whether there are abuses, whether there is a case of vote rigging. If this has happened and if we are getting more and more of them, then it will seriously affect the credibility of the elections. So on this occasion, the administration has come up with the idea of address proof. I think it is something that we should take seriously and we should support it. Now the question is, other than providing address proofs, I think other members have also said that we have to make sure that for the system to work, for those who are engaged in vote rigging, for those who are abusing the system, there should be a deterrent effect. And this can be done through effective random checking as well as the penalties. Now, I understand that the penalties are to be raised, and I hope that this will be effective. And then for random checking, as to whether it can bring in a very effective deterrent effect, well, I want to know about the percentage of the random checking. The percentage as well as the methodology, please tell us. And do you plan to improve it so that you can enhance the rate of detection of problematic cases? In this way, we can make it more effective in the deterrent effect. Mr. Lee, in 2012, we carried out a review and we have set up a checking mechanism. There are two ways. First of all, random checking. During the election year and on election year, among the 3 million electors, we do carry out an election, we do carry out a random checking, like in a like 3% for a non-election year. And then we've also got a more specific checking. If we have got some information on hand, we'll be more focused, like the housing department and the housing society. On the basis of their household information, we'll carry out a check. And then for multiple electors and multiple surnames of electors, we're not saying that when an address has got multiple electors or multiple surnames, it will certainly be an abuse. No, we try to find out about reason. Sometimes with multiple surnames, because the former tenants have moved out, but they haven't cancelled their registration, and therefore we have got a large number of surnames. This is not against, it is not an offence, but then we want to make it accurate. And then we have got non-residential addresses, commercial addresses, and they're suspicious, so we want to carry out an investigation and get it confirmed. And then for units in buildings which have been demolished or vacated, again, we want to get information to verify the situation. And we'd like to do more in the current VR cycle. Other than getting information from the REO, we'd like to seek help from the district office. They know that certain buildings have been vacated and they can alert us. And then we'll also ask the URA for redevelopment projects. When it is made known to us, then for the addresses referring to buildings that are to be redeveloped, we will be more alert. We believe that such efforts do work. Not that we can drive out vote rigging or other unlawful activities. In the past, for cases referred to the police, just a small number of them have been substantiated. But whenever we find that addresses are not accurate or electors have moved out and their address is no longer accurate, then we'll try our best to help the electors to update the particulars. If we can't, then we just have to take it out from the final register. So all that we do is all based on making it credible and accurate. I want to know whether you've got any measures to enhance the system. Could take this question, Mr. Lee. As I have said, for buildings that have been demolished or vacated, we'd like to do more about them. we have got 3 million more than 3 million electors. Almost half of them are living in public housing managed by the HA and the HAS. Now, for the cross-matching, what we want to do is that if an address has been registered and we will try to see if the elector can confirm where he lives. So for the exercise in the future, we'll try to check with the electors as to whether it is accurate or not. So we are trying to work out a model with the HA. We have got 1.4 million electors. For each and every address, we hope that within the cycle, we are able to verify them. When there are inaccuracies, we try to rectify it or update it. All right, Mr. Riley. We want to open fair and just elections. For the DAB, it has been reported, and at this and other meetings, there have been statements saying that there's something wrong. We'll take this seriously, like vote rigging, abusing the mechanism, or electors have complained that they have been they have had their particulars changed with such justification. We want all such cases to be handled seriously. Is it fine for you to disclose the progress of the investigation to us here? And then for other cases, I think there are implicit or explicit accusations that a particular party is vote rigging. I don't think this should be condoned because the investigation hasn't been completed, the accusations haven't been substantiated. Now, you told the media that there is no evidence to show that there is vote rigging in the last DC election. On the other hand, residential addresses of certain electors have been changed without their knowledge, and the claims and objection mechanisms have been abused. Please tell us whether this has happened or not. And thirdly, I turn to your proposals. You would like to enhance the penalties to make them more effective in the deterrent effect. We do agree with you. This is because all along the VR has been operated on the principle of facilitating the electors. For us to be good at gatekeeping, we must make sure that the penalties can deter law-breaking activities. You have also said that application for new registration and application for change of particulars, you would like to have an address proof. I have yet to be convinced. I think you need to have the right support measures before we can really talk about this. Say, for example, an effective random checking mechanism. You told us that you have had specific investigation, but what about new registration and also change of particulars? Have you carried out any specific investigation or checking? It seems that more complaints are about change of address. Are you going to check more addresses? And then I turn to my fourth point. I think you need to diversify your means of contact. In the past, you would only be using the postal means. I think this is outdated. You talk about ordinary mail rather than registered mail. Yes, I agree with this approach. But email, mobile phone, or home visits, etc., have been mentioned in your paper. Would you like to update your approach of contacting the electors? On the election day, I made a statement. I think as of that day, we didn't have evidence to show that there was vote rigging. As far as the information I have with me is concerned, I think the observation is still true. As to whether there is a suspicion that there has been abuse or there has been a malicious change of particulars, Well, indeed, I've heard such concerns, and therefore, in our paper, we have come up with some proposals. This is because of what has been observed, and that's why we've come back with this proposal. Enhancing the penalties, I'm glad to hear from different political parties that it is the right direction. And some members have even said that the proposed enhancement is not good enough. But it seems that enhancing the penalties is the right direction. As to the magnitude, I think we can have more discussion. And Mr. Lee can supplement if there is time for him. Mr. Lee, for new registration, we have always been carrying out random checking. But then we need to be careful about one point. Most of the applications were received in the last week or two before the deadline. If we are talking about 200,000 to 300,000 application forms, it will be difficult to have the random checking because it easily takes 2 to 3 weeks' time as we have to wait for a feedback from the elector. That's about the change of particulars. Now, for the VR, it's easier to control the time. For the change of particulars, during the last cycle, what we saw was that in most cases, it was a matter of the identification papers have been used to make a change of the registered address. In our paper, we've said that for the coming cycle, we will send a notice in addition to changing the residential particulars. And if we have got the mobile phone number or the email address, then we'll make use of such additional channels to inform the elector that there has been a change of particulars. If they haven't put in an application themselves, then they can approach us. In other words, we try so that to a certain extent we can eradicate this phenomenon. Now, Ms. Sterry Lee raised a point, and I want to say that under the ordinance, the REO has got certain powers in three areas. First of all, in the case of a new registration, the applicant can be asked to provide information for electors already in the register. If they know that there are something wrong with the particulars, they can, the REO can ask the elector concerned to provide more information. If the elector can't do so, then the REO is empowered to deregister this elector.
As for the information concerning the electors, the REO can also go to public organizations or public sources of information to verify the information. Yes, we have that power. Now, so you can see in the past cases of checking, we have been doing so, and it's been done on a written basis. As to whether this can be done, the investigation can be more in-depth, then it will depend on the actual arrangements. In the past, even when we have done house visits, we do not have the legal right to, because our voters' registration gather information there, but only on a written basis. If the electors provide written information and it is false information, then he may lose the status as a voter. But if there is any criminal offense, and of course we will take it to the enforcement organ department or enforcement authorities, but it is not up to the REA to do any in-depth investigations. We do not have that power. Now, in the future, in terms of checking and also spot checking work, because at present there is no documentation or document evidence that we require. It is on a truthful declaration basis. And in future, if we can have more information and evidence, then the enforcement authorities and our office will find it easier for the investigation to be successful. And also for the those who want to perpetrate this kind of practice, and if it's criminal in nature in particular, then they will have to assume a bigger risk. Mr. Chair, concerning vote rigging and changing of addresses in an unlawful manner, I think this is something very serious, and we have to be very serious in our treatment of such and handling of such practices, and we must put them under the penalties of the law. Now, whether it is the LegCo members or our Kaifengs, I have come across cases where they complain that their addresses have been unlawfully used. Now, it is very good that we have heard the opinions from all sides, but we can also see that at present, especially for voters' registration, we do see that it is a positive attitude. That is to say, we are encouraging people to register as voters. It is responsibilities and rights, but for providing address proof, I think we have to be very careful in considering that, because the citizens may say we are only honoring our citizens' responsibility, and in fact we are not all that desirous of becoming a voter. And in encouraging our citizens in becoming voters, there is an education process, and it is an incremental process. How should we have more measures? Do we have to ask for so much evidence? And it is also true that some people actually cannot come up with such evidence. Do people have to have a mailing address with internet and technology advancement these days? And for some people who reside with the family members, do I have utilities proof of address? I myself may not have it because my wife will be the registered person. I mean, there are all these issues. It is not all that straightforward. And in fact, it would adversely affect voters' registration. So I think in terms of the how you go about it, the procedures, we can carefully consider it. As for the penalties, this is insufficient. This is a an unlawful practice. I mean, it is too light still. 2 years imprisonment and $10,000 penalty, too light. And if you look at the relevant unlawful practice, in it is $500,000 and 7 years imprisonment for abuse of the system. There is not much difference. It is still false declarations and also vote rigging. So I think the penalties should be heftier. Should you not consider that? And you also mentioned that there will be telephone verifications, and you need a telephone number to get hold of the person. You will have to, just on the case of address change. It is much like the bank. If you have certain expenses over and above a certain ceiling, there will be a message sent to you to ask whether you have made that expense. Can you do that? Think about that. So in the actual practice, can you perhaps beef it up? And that would be better than what you are suggesting now, providing residence evidence. Well, it's easy for you to put this into place, but on the other hand, the consequences are dire. You've used up your time. Well, Mr. Tam, Mr. Chair, for the penalties making it more heavy, perhaps we can go back and talk to the legal department. Yes, we can consider that. Chen Qichun, for providing address evidence to a certain extent would not discourage some citizens in registering for voters, but to select between the two, I would still want to go for it. I mean, in my constituency, I have come across cases where there are claims that the address had been used, or perhaps it's just that a person was careless in writing 18th floor instead of 19th floor, and the person had asked whether he or she should go to the ICAC directly or to the REO office. There are a number of such cases. Some parties, political parties, are not convinced. But how do we minimize this kind of cases? If there are no better means than to provide residence evidence. Well, I would still want to go back to the elderly institutions scenario. Some elderlies have been, without their knowing, being registered as voters, and it's very difficult to resolve the cases because the elderlies may not remember so clearly. But of course, if the elderlies very clearly remember that he or she had not registered, then you can go by that evidence. But for my mother, for instance, the two times that she has given evidence were basically different, the evidence. Now, there are some 5,000 elderlies in these elderly institutions, and you have looked into 3,000 plus of them. That's a high proportion. But still, I have been told that there are elderlies who do not very clearly remember that they have not been registered. Now, given such cases, what does the REO do? I'm sure the elderly institutions would want to help, but they would say that they have not registered the elderlies on their own, but perhaps they have let in other organizations or bodies to register the elderlies. Well, I know that they would know, that these institutions would know that they have let in certain bodies. And perhaps they will have certain information. Some of the elderlies are 70 or 80 years old, and they would not even be able to write out the address of the elderly institution or even their own ID card number. There would be some administrative support, I would think, from the elderly institutions in providing the information of the elderlies. Given that, perhaps we can provide some guidelines. For example, if the institutions had indeed accepted and allowed blanket or massive registering of the elderlies, and in our inspection, can we perhaps ask the institutions whether they have let in what welfare groups or church groups to come in and register voters of the elderlies? Secondly, perhaps the elderly institutions should notify the family members if they know. Now, I know that the REO would send letters to the elderly institution to verify that the elderly person had been registered. However, well, that had always been so. All letters were forwarded to the family members, but not from the REO. It's not that the person or we want to sue the elderly institution. That's a matter between the family and the elderly institution. But should you not specify or give out guidelines saying that the elderly institutions should notify the family members if there should be such registrations, or whether the elderly institutions had registered on behalf of the elderlies? Mr. Chair, I think this is worth looking into. There is a ICAC issued pamphlet concerning clean registering of voters and voting, and that's been sent to the elderly institutions as well, and whether we can build in some of the points as outlined by Chen Qichun, I think we can look into that. Mr. Lee? Thank you, Mr. Chair. Mr. Chen Qichun had raised certain concern points, and I know that there are concerns within society as well. Now, before the district board's election last round, we have had some communications on exactly that point, and the elderly institutions have been notified. That is, there is a part in the stipulations concerning the allowing in of certain political parties or candidates for going into the institutions, that there should be a fairness rule, that they cannot refuse some candidates or parties and allow others. And I also know that there are certain manuals or codes with it for the institutions themselves, and that is, institutions cannot abuse the information of the elderly residing in the institution, otherwise they would run foul of the code as well. And in our registration of candidates, we can definitely look into this, and we can talk to the people responsible at the institutions. Now, as for Mr. Chan Chi-chun's suggestion of registering the visitors into the institution, whether it is for registering electors or by different bodies, I think that is worth looking into. Increasing the transparency is better than penalties. This is to increase the confidence in the system. There are two sides we need to balance. On the one hand, we should not say that the elderly in the institutions, because of their cognitive abilities or their memory abilities, and therefore we need to have added requirements or restrictions on their registration. That cannot be, because we have to respect the elderly's rights for registration and voting. But on the other hand, we have social concerns as well, so that we have to increase transparency. Yes, I think that is desirable. Ms. Wong, pick one. Mr. Chair, concerning elderly institutions, of course we have to respect the elderly in their right for voting. However, there are those who do not have the cognitive power, and they have been rolled into or wheeled into the voting booths and for by whatever force. Now, if the operators of the elderly institutions themselves have certain political inclinations, then what do you do? Now, if the elderly, without their knowing, have been wheeled into voting, well, how do we protect against that? And what if the elderly institutions simply do not listen to you? And what if they allow only friendly, quote-unquote, organizations or bodies to go into the institutions to register the elderly and also bring the elderly to the voting? What do you do then?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Under the electoral laws, we do not have the power to monitor the elderly homes. The operation will be subject to the regulatory work of the SWD. We have got the guidelines, and also the elderly homes have got a code of conduct. If they deliberately facilitate a particular group or obstruct another group, then it means that they are against the principle of being fair to all candidates. So for the EAC to receive such a complaint, there will certainly be a follow-up act. Now, on the questions of privacy, now, if an elderly home is to use the personal particulars of a elderly person residing at their home for non-related purposes, then it could be a breach. If it is a case of abusing the personal data of another person, then when we receive a complaint, it will be referred to the Office of the Commissioner of Personal Data. So you won't take the initiative to find out how many elderly homes have been following your advice. Are you going to just pass the buck to the Privacy Commissioner? Mr. Chairman, we want to know whether the operator of the home has been abusing the personal particulars of the elderly residents for purposes unrelated to the operation of the home. Then it is a case rightly in the court of the Privacy Commissioner. If in the course of election something is done which goes against the principle of fairness, then I'm sure the EAC will look into the matter. Mr. Chairman, I want to ask a question about electors who change their addresses every time there is an election. I want to know whether you can track such electors from your computer system. Are you able to detect such electors who change their addresses every time there is an election so as to find out whether they are always moving homes all the time or whether every time when there is an election there will be this deliberate move so as to migrate the electors to constituencies which will be to the favor of a particular group? Mr. Lee, we have a database. If we want to do it, yes, this can be done. However, it depends on what happens. Elections are usually held once every 4 years. For you to make a change of your particulars, usually we get more applications in the year preceding the election year. Sometimes people do move house more frequently. So can we assume and become suspicious that when there is a change of address prior to the registration or prior to the election year, it is a tactic? In fact, the number of such cases isn't great. Our database can be searched in this way. We can go back to find out whether we have such anomalies, say, for example, changing the address 3 times for 3 different elections. Mr. Chairman, if it is technically feasible, please do so, so as to find out whether there is a problem. Do I have time left? No, you don't. 4 minutes only. I'll wait for my second time. Ms. Alice Mack. Mr. Chairman, first of all, it is also stated in the paper that if electors have their particulars changed, and I think the administration and the REO are aware of this, there was this FTU member who found prior to the election that the address had been changed. Had the REO been poorer in keeping the gate while they asked for others to be vigorous in the procedures, if they are being careless in the processing of application of change of particulars, then it seems that the electors have to sit at the terminal for a long time every day, so that once every 3 or 4 hours we have to check whether our particulars have been changed by others. Now, the REO has said that a letter will be sent to the elector concerned should there be a change of address. If the address has been changed by others for him, then he will never get that inquiry letter. So what can you do to address such problems? There is an elector had his address changed. Is there a way to verify the information? In fact, they have left a telephone number on the application form, but you never try to call the elector. Do you have the manpower to make sure that the checking is proper? And then for the objection mechanism, according to the paper, indeed between 2011 and 2015, for this particular year, all out of a sudden, we have got 1,000 more objections. If we just rely on the means that you have referred to, can we really prevent abuses? Well, indeed, this is very bad. I may be fine, and then somebody suspects that I am cheating, and then he will lodge an objection. And for me, as a person being objected, I have to prove myself right. Sometimes I just have no idea as to why someone would like to lodge an objection against me. I may have registered my address for over a decade, and then another person may just don't like my face, and then he lodges an objection, and then I can't tell why there is an objection against me. So I just wonder whether it is right to have the onus of proof on the elector being objected. Now, if there is a change of address, it is proposed that it should be a requirement to fill out the former address as well. I think it's easy to do that. So for the change of address application form, it's easy to give the existing address and the new address. I don't think this can prevent an improper change of address or a false address being given. For malicious change of address cases, well, in this cycle, I think the REO colleagues were quite unhappy about this. We didn't want this to happen, but then we have got an honest system. For the REO's information, I think it is quite limited. When we get a piece of information, if we know that it is a case of, for us to find out that it is a case of malicious change, it will be difficult. If the ID number is correct, if the name is correct, then basically we'll believe that the applicant is indeed the elector involved. Now that we have seen so many cases, well, in the past, we have been providing our personal data for different purposes in social and economic activities. Our latest proposal may not be the panacea. Even if we can verify that the name is correct on the strength of the Immigration Department's information, we can still not be sure. So it's better if a mobile phone number is given, so that by way of an SMS, we can alert the elector that there has been a change of particulars, like a change of address. If it is found out that it is not the case, then they can approach us. Of course, if we haven't got a telephone number but an email address, then we'll try to approach the elector by email. The consultation document has also said that whether there has been any abuse about the objection mechanism. Well, in some cases, the objector has only provided scanty information, so it is difficult for the REO to carry out the investigation because we didn't know what's gone wrong, and the RO will have to adjudicate the case. In the absence of the objector, it means that he can only work on the information provided by the REO. Therefore, the consultation document has said that perhaps in an objection case, the applicant should bear more responsibility and he should be asked to provide more information to the RO. Thank you. Next, Mr. Ng Sing. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I had not wanted to speak, but then I was provoked by a sentence of a particular member's statement. That is, the system is going to wreck as far as confidence in the VR is concerned. Well, for the latest DC election, the voting rate was very high. So I would like to ask the administration to comment on this particular opinion, that is, people losing confidence in the VR. But how does that tally with the turnout rate? Now, for the Legislative Council members, even those political parties who used to boast who are so proud of themselves of being rational and reasonable, they've been joining the filibustering. So I think this is very different from the statement just made about the confidence in the VR. There have been observations about the turnout rate as well as the registration rate of the elderly as well as the young. Have you got any observations? Would you like to share your observations with us? And lastly, for addresses, whether they are proper or not, or whether they're accurate or not, well, we've got so many people living in subdivided units, probably they will be moving house frequently. And then we've got their backpackers. They may spend a night in Tai O and then going from one hotel to another. And if they earn $90,000 a month, and if he's a sort of a singleton, he can afford moving from one hotel to another. I think we have got legislators who are in such a category. So do we really need guidelines to regulate the situation about the age profile and the characteristics? Every time after the completion of the VR cycle, we do have the details. In the election cycle in 2015, 260,000 newly registered electors, over 60,000 are between 18 and 20, 24% of the new registrations. So the registration rate is 49.9% for the age group of 18 to 20. For those aged between 18 and 30, the registration rate is 64.4%. When compared with 2014, it was 59.7%, so there has been an increase. For the other age groups, we have an age band of 5 years. I think basically it is more or less the same as before. But of course, the overall registration rate in 2015, it has peaked. What about the comment that the system is about to collapse? I haven't really heard people making such a comment. For the latest district council election, according to certain opinion polls, well, in fact, those interviewed were happy with the arrangements. More than half of them were happy with the electoral arrangements. So basically, they thought that it has been conducted in accordance with the law. As to the electoral results, well, it is not of concern to us. We leave it with the relevant members and parties. Anybody wishing to ask questions in the first round? If not, then second round. Emily Lau and Helena Wong, 4 minutes each. Mr. Chairman, we've received many comments from the electors saying that they have no confidence in the VR, so please improve it. It is said that there is an observation that there is an abuse of the objection mechanism. We don't work on observations, we work on the facts. If there have been abuses, how many cases have been ruled as abuses by the RO? Mention has been made about vote rigging. It will be difficult to follow up those cases. There are clear cases. Clearly, there are cases about multiple electors and also an address being registered where the building has been demolished.
There should be a difference there. So I have to put this question to Mr. Tam. You said observation. I heard observation from a colleague, a LegCo member. So does that mean that we have to change the law? Secondly, concerning the penalty, yes, it has to be heavier so as to signal them. But let us not threaten them. What? You want to bring all the objectors' names onto the website? Do you understand that the pressure that will bring to the citizens? And for the elderly institutions, would you please talk to the Social Welfare Department? Do not allow anybody to register the elderlies. I mean, if everybody goes to the elderly institutions to register the elderly, wouldn't that cause confusion? Now, if we want to have the elderlies vote, their family members or the staff only should be the people helping them to do the voting. But for the rest of it, actually, I'm sure you do not pay any regard to that. But there are loopholes. Not just anybody can bring the elderlies to the vote, right? Yes, concerning Ms. Emily Lau's point, in our this is our suggestion. It's one of the recommended or suggested measures, not that we will bring it to practice. But basically, for the objectors, what we are saying, they should provide a reasonable grounds for bringing up the objection. It is not true that we would want them to knock on the door and go into the unit to gather evidence. And I'm sure at the point of changing the law, I'm sure we will have a lot of opportunities, including the wording for the change of law to... No, Mr. Chairman, it says here, gathering evidence for the objector. Mr. Chair, that is only a descriptive clause. And when we actually amend the law, in the next step we will have to consider the wording, and we will have time and opportunity to consider the wording. And another point, what about the court's decisions? Now, Mr. Chairman, concerning the 2,000 plus electors, what are the different cases? Perhaps I should ask Mr. Lee to respond on that. Mr. Chair, concerning the objections, in the last meeting, I have reported the numbers. There are over 1,400 voters, and over 200 of them have been ruled by the RO to be taken off the register. And for the rest of the cases, we have followed up on the cases as well. In our verification process, we have found out more information about the residences, and we have provided that information to the RO. And for some cases, we were not able to find the person involved, and the RO, there are about 100 such voters, and we will be, in this round, try to locate these voters, and we would want to verify with them whether the residences are as contained in the register. What about abuse cases? Now, the RO does not segregate abuse cases or non-abuse cases, but rather he makes a decision on the weight of the evidence and information. And there were 290 plus cases wherein he found that he was not able to verify the address of these voters, and he was not able to get in touch with them, so they were taken off the register. Well, Mr. Chair, I think the wording should be used very carefully. I mean, for those which cannot be verified, for the cases which with no verification possibilities, what about those? Mr. Chair, for the REO, if we receive any objections, we have to send those cases to the RO. We do not have the right to withhold certain cases. But you have recommendations, right? Well, according to the instructions of the RO, we will do certain investigations and checking. Before that, we will have preliminary checking. And what is the result of your checking? Well, for each case, it would be different. Sometimes the RO would want us to, as soon as possible, get hold of the person involved to verify whether he indeed resides in that unit, apart from writing him, calling him, other channels as well to reach him. As for elderly institutions, we also follow the instructions of the RO. We go to the institution to ask the elderly whether he's done the registration, and we will provide that information back to the RO as well. And what about providing the objectors' names on the website? This is new, isn't it? Well, in the legal procedures, there is no such requirement. We can discuss whether this is reasonable as a procedure, but I can also raise one point, and that is the entire process is very tight in time where it involves a court, and the court usually takes 2 to 3 days for the voter to appear in court. And This may not have to do with exactly what we're talking about, but if the voter can access information on their net, then the actual conveyance of the information through the internet would be faster and easier. No, I object to this. You are saying that you put the objector's name on the internet. Are you saying that you want to disclose to the world that, hey, this person objects to you? All right. And the elderly institutions, what about those? Well, from the cases, as reported by my colleagues, the elderly institutions are different in their practice. Some are very loose, some are not. For the government elderly institutions and the non-government run ones, they are different in their practice. Now, for private institutions, for private elderly institutions, as with other private institutions, it's very difficult for us to intervene with how they handle this. But when it comes to voter registration, as much as possible, for the principles and regulations that have to be complied with, we will provide that as information to the operators of the institutions so that they cannot say that without knowledge they have infringed on these regulations, especially where it comes to privacy. And the institutions are basically cooperative and they're willing to listen to us, but at the end of the day, we cannot ask them what to do, teach them what to do, because it is not required by law. And therefore, in the registration cycle and before the next round of LegCo elections, we will try our best to remind the elderly institutions, because we do not want to do anything that will raise suspicions among within the community, because it also will have to do with the attitude, and rather the negative attitude that the community will hold against the registered voters who are residing in elderly institutions. We do not want to raise that kind of negative perception within the community. Appendix 3 in your consultative paper, A. For rejected or registration voter cards or photo cards which cannot be delivered, I would like to know about that. For the latest round of registration, how many of these have been sent back to you? How many of these cases have you looked into, and what are the results? Do you have such information? In the 2015 cycle, concerning sent back notifications, they are not that many because these voting notifications will only be sent where there are elections. So before the district board elections, there were just a couple of election rounds, and there were about 500 of such notifications. Yes, and we have looked into all these cases. All 500 plus of them? Yes, all of them. Yes, and that was done within the five-year cycle. What are the results? Mostly it is because they have moved away from the address, and if we can find the new address through the telephone, that will be done. Otherwise, if we cannot contact the person, it will be taken off the register. Now, we have over 3 million voters in Hong Kong. 500, you said. That is lower than I had expected. I know of situations where there are complaints received where the residents had received this voting notifications. However, the notification bears a name, an addressee, which is of a person not residing in this household, never had resided in this household. And some of the people who receive these notifications just throw away these notifications. So at the lobby of the buildings, the residences, there would be these thrown away notifications. That is the reason why you have only received 500 plus such notifications. Do you know about those which have been thrown away? Perhaps you can ask the management companies to provide a box for the dropping in of such notifications, or maybe you make it mandatory for them, stamp free, to mail back the notifications to you?
Well, Mr. Chair, perhaps I should be specific. I'm talking about the 2015 registration cycle. And before then, there was another cycle for by-election. And at this point in time, there are 50,000 to 6,000 registration cards received that have been sent back to us. The number is big, and we will, before the next round, follow up with all the cases. Now, all these turned back cards, in fact, I would say it's a high proportion. We will continue to do our work regarding that. As for the management office of the residence buildings, there are people, residents, who would drop these notifications into the drop box. Hopefully, they will not put it into the bin. And yes, and it will be sent back to us through the postal office. And it is perhaps that the residence had not been renewed, and we will follow up with them and renew the residence. So you are saying that you will do the work, ask the bigger residence estates to collect these notification cards? Would you do that and send it back to you? Well, in the mail for voting registration, there is a point, there is a notice saying that if you are not the addressee, send this back to our office. But given your suggestion, perhaps we can, in certain fora, talk to the management officers or management companies of such residences to ask them to do so. Now, these 50,000, 60,000 cases, will you verify all of them? Yes, we will go through and follow up with all of them, and that would take time. First of all, we do not send out a letter, but we will try to contact the voter, because if we mail a letter to the voter, to the address, it will be meaningless. So we will look at the telephone number, email address, we'll try those routes. If we cannot find them, we will mail the letter according to the legal the laws as prescribed in the law, but we'll probably not be able to find them through the mail. Yes. Mr. Chair, concerning public checking, I'm sure you cannot do this comprehensively. Concerning the accuracy of the data, it is only relative because the government cannot ensure that the register is 100% complete and accurate. But even so, I would think the government should do its utmost to make the photo registration system to make it as fair and as just as possible. Well, it says the optimization of the registration. Can you not use another wording? In Chinese, it is yaofa. That is a Chinese wording. Now, this is perhaps unrelated, but yaofa is objectionable. That in Chinese, the wording. This is mainland wording. Use something else. And also in the paper, it says that the REO, in carrying out stringent work, does not include checking with the other government departments concerning the addresses. I'm raising this with regard to the housing department or the urban renewal authorities. Now, if you do not verify such information, such as those which are awaiting demolition, but you have that information, the housing development, the housing department, and for urban renewal, the authority, they would have information in the units which have been vacated for urban renewal. Well, I mean, all the information that they have on hand would be relevant to you. So your kind of stringent verification, why would you not include that? Now, also, for the two types of buildings that I've talked about, including those which are to be demolished by the housing development and for urban renewal units which have been vacated because of urban renewal, very often these are used for vote rigging, using those residences. Some parties who are themselves at fault are crying foul. And every time it attracts a lot of media attention with a lot of detailed reporting, and our panel had talked about that at length in previous rounds as well. Now, it comes to this time already. And you're still not sure whether you will do this or not, and I find this problematic because the relevant information does not have to do with any privacy information. It does not need legislative changes. And besides, you are coordinating with public organizations, the Urban Renewal Authority and the Housing Department, Government Department. Yes, there would be some private information, and you will have to check with the privacy office, but at 2012, you should have done that work already. Why did you not look at the other possible resolutions? I hope Mr. Lee will respond to that.
I read the consultation document, and from previous discussion, I think the majority of the proposals of my support, I think that they are fine and they can enhance the system. In particular, the administration is willing to reconsider the need for address proof. Of course, I know there's some objection to that. It may cause inconvenience, but even for the telecommunication operators have asked for an address proof if you would like to open an account. So it should be fine, and it should just become a habit. So I think it's important for you to drop the criteria as to what is meant by an address proof. And do you have discretion for special cases? I think you need to consider such matters. And then if you ask for address proof from those who are new registrations as well as an application for change of particulars, I think it will be good. And then the RO doesn't have to have such a huge workload, and he won't criticize you, Mr. Tam. Well, the judge is also a human being. He will be infuriated and he will criticize you. Vote rigging. Undeniably, this is also serious, but then it is very difficult to gather the evidence and investigate the matter. Therefore, we need to enhance the penalty. So I think the government should consider enhancing the penalties for a second conviction. Mr. Chairman, if I may have a little bit more time, and that's about the homes for the elderly. Well, every time we have an election, we always have something similar. That is, there's an allegation that the operators have abused the system. In 2010, there was the allegation that people were asked to write down some information in their palm so as to vote for a particular candidate. We saw the same this time. It is said that 6 cases have been referred to the law enforcement agencies for investigation, but just 6 out of the many complaints. I just wonder why the media could expose the cases. When we were lecturers, we talk about 5W and 1H, when, where, who, as to how, it is unknown. We don't have why and what. When we are in the media, we have asked for the 6 elements to be present, 5W and 1H. Now we know when, who, and where. So why is it that you haven't carried out the investigation? Well, on the other hand, the reporters have reported on it. So try your best to answer my relevant questions. please keep it brief. Yes, I'll answer two of them, and then Mr. Lee will talk about the latest arrangements concerning cross-checking as well as working with the property management agencies. Definition for address proof. Mr. Wong wondered if we could exercise discretion. Yes, even though it is not in the paper, I'm sure we'll be pragmatic and will give it serious and positive consideration. Enhancing the penalties, I know he is in support. He has also got a new idea, that is, further enhancing the penalties for a second conviction. Mr. Lee, cross-checking with all the departments. For the points made by Mr. Wong, this is indeed the direction that we are working towards. In our paper, we've said that we'll work on that, and in fact, we have already gained some progress for buildings already demolished. As to why some electors have their addresses at a building that has been demolished, there is a time lag, because if all the occupants have moved out, and before an application has been made to the BD to demolish a building, we won't know whether all the tenants have moved out. Now, for URA, if it is confirmed that all the tenants have moved out, then we will be alerted, and then we can work on that basis. For the HAD, their colleagues would also cooperate with us. If at the district level, they are aware that certain buildings have been totally vacated, even though the relevant property developer hasn't got any plans to demolish it or redevelop it, we should still be informed so that our information will be more up to date. I think it will assist our checking. For the HD and the HS, earlier on, I've already explained that is for our cross-checking, we have singled out those who claim to be residing at HD or HS buildings. Now, we are going to go through each and every address. It will involve 1.4 million electors. There are also certain technical concerns. We try our best to complete the task within the current cycle. We believe that at least we can make a start in the current cycle. For the homes for the aged, Mr. Wong mentioned 6 cases. I think Mr. Wong mentioned that when we dealt with the objections cases, the RO dealt with 6 cases in which the electors said that no signatures have been put onto the application forms. So the RO would like to refer such cases to the police. Now, if this comes to our attention, we'll refer them to the law enforcement agencies. We have had a very lively debate. It is good. The administration is carrying out the consultation. So the government will take your views into account. For me, I think we need to strike a balance. We don't want to be too intrusive. On the other hand, we would like to prevent the abuse. We want to minimize the loopholes. Well, currently, it seems to me that we have got complaints. They have been exaggerated without strong evidence. We need to bear this point in mind. For vote rigging, the judiciary has been handing down heavy penalties when the case can be proved, and imprisonment is not uncommon. So I believe that there is a deterrent effect. So we aren't simply talking about a fine. In fact, imprisonment has been imposed. Well, if you query that an address is inaccurate, then the complainant should bear certain responsibility. I think it is reasonable. Otherwise, we have what we got last time. All in all, whether we are talking about vote rigging, the number is limited, or false addresses, I think the RO has ruled on the cases and the number is found to be limited. But still, we want to make it perfect, and the administration does have a responsibility here. Let us turn to the next item, 2016 VR campaign. Two papers are involved, and I'll just check with the Undersecretary whether you would like to brief us on the papers. The papers have been given to members, and we have only got 15 minutes left, so please draw attention to the highlights. Undersecretary. Mr. Chairman, please speak up. Yes, please speak into the microphone, and then the volume can be enhanced. Mr. Chairman, in 2016, we are going to have the Legislative Council general election as well as the Election Committee subsector elections. So we are going to launch a large-scale VR campaign. We are going to start the publicity in March 2016. Just now we talked about enhancing the VR system, and we did touch upon the proposal to advance the statutory deadlines. Depending on the outcome of the current consultation exercise, we plan to do the following in early 2016. That is, we're going to move amendments to the subsidiary legislation so that for the 2016 VR cycle, the statutory deadline for changes will be the same as that for new registration. In other words, it will be advanced to the 2nd of May 2016. In other words, the publicity campaign will work on this new statutory deadline and will publicize the new deadline. Another point is that for the campaign, we are going to highlight our system, the online voter information inquiry system, so that electors can check the particulars. On the 1st of June, we are going to publish the provisional register as well as the omission list. Once again, we will remind the electors that they can make use of the telephone hotline as well as the OVIES to check the particulars. Thirdly, we will make use of the VR campaign to alert the citizens that they need to provide true and accurate information, and they need to change the residential address in a timely fashion. And we'll continue to check the information, and we will carry out the inquiry process. And if there's evidence in suspected cases of false information, then the REO will refer the cases to the law enforcement agencies for follow-up and investigation.
As for the expenses for this campaign, it is 17.4 million, and it is said that the 2016 publicity expenses is largely slashed from the 2015. I would want to clarify that that is not the case. In the 2012 voter registration publicity, at the time the expenses was 1.2 million, and 2016 publicity expenses is some 5 million more compared to 2012, and compared to this year, the 1.69 million is another additional 909 million. So with the forms received and also the professional registers, the operation expenses, put those all together, the total budget for 2016 is 6.8 million. And again, that is bigger in total budget than the previous years, standing at 68 million. And so for people with different background, etc., we will be providing the education and publicity to them. That is by way of presentation. I'd be happy to, myself together with RE would be very, REO would be very happy to receive any questions. Chen Qijun, Zhang Huafeng, Wang Yongman, Hu Jiwei, Emily Lau,
3 minutes each, please. Can you please be careful of the time? Thank you, Mr. Chair. Thank you for clarifying the expenses for publicity, for registration, because when this came out, the media called and said that this is a 50% less than the previous round. Does it mean that they want to register fewer voters? Well, for the 2016, the 12 million and the 16 million after, can you give us the breakdown, please? How did you use the money? And you mentioned that it is only 500,000 compared to 2016, compared to 2015, and that is not a big increase. Now, from 18 to 30 years young people, the registration rate is only 60% or less, and that is rather low. And as I've mentioned last time, we should come up with innovative measures in registering the people, use media channels such as some internet, TV and radio stations and websites, and the young people who are politically conscious to access these. And also there are other schemes such as the gender approach scheme under the Equal Opportunities Commission. Perhaps you can devolve that kind of responsibility to these organizations and schemes, because they understand their constituencies better. Rather, it is more cost effective than you providing generic APIs and through the traditional media. Well, thank you very much for Mr. Chan's suggestions. You were asking whether we can provide certain resources for bodies to do their own publicity to the voters. Well, we can go back and think about it. As for publicity focused on the young people, apart from traditional platforms and channels, recently indeed we have been utilizing more social media and the internet. We have referred to market surveys and research, especially for younger people, for some of the Facebook and YouTube, Open Rise, Yahoo, and other internet platforms. We have, in fact, placed considerable advertisements. So I would think the messages had reached the young people. Now, apart from internet platforms, there are some actual voters registration activities. What about net radio, internet radio and TV stations? Have you done that, and would you want to access that this time round? Now, as for the selection as to what social media on which we'll place advertisements, our criteria basically follow the survey results of the market research. As for internet radio stations, I can go back and look into them. But what comes to mind right now is that if we want to use the resources wisely, we should perhaps place the advertisements on platforms which reach more users. I do not agree that the traditional radio stations are more popular than the internet radio. I mean, there are no ratings from the traditional radio stations either. Well, I will go back and look into it. But for the citizens using these platforms, I would think that they have a certain passion for public affairs, and they are participant in fora of public affairs. And I would think for this kind of groups, their desire to be registered as voters would be generally higher than that of the ordinary young person. So if we're talking about encouraging the youngster who would not be usually receiving such messages
encouraging them to register, perhaps that would be more appropriate. Now, for those who go on the internet to for video games, I mean, perhaps you can access those channels as well, because I've gone on one such platform to do publicity for voter registration, and the reception was very good. Yes, what about APIs? The government does not have to pay for APIs on traditional media platforms. Is that true? Yes, we'll go back to think about it. Chang Hua-feng. Mr. Chair, I'm in support of the work that they do in voter registration and publicity. But when it comes to constituents, functional constituencies, I think the publicity thereof is insufficient. Rarely are there APIs talking about the importance of functional constituencies to the stability of Hong Kong, and therefore the people of Hong Kong, and even for functional constituency voters, they do not know that they would have two votes under the ordinary and under the functional constituency system. And therefore, there had been slandering of functional constituencies, saying that this is small group voting, and the citizens of Hong Kong therefore do not understand or are misled about the or misunderstand the functional constituency elections. Emily Lau, can you not disturb? But basically, functional constituencies cover a larger, even larger geographical area. And this is unfair to the functional constituencies. So would the government be considering putting more resources into promoting functional constituency voting so that there will be better understanding of the citizens concerning functional constituency elections, that this is not small group elections, it is big group elections. Administration. Mr. Chair, concerning the publicity activities, apart from the territorial elections for functional constituencies, we also have certain focused publicity. We have done some work in this regard. Some 230 constituent bodies, we have already sent letters to them calling on them to have their members register as voters, and also in 30 bodies in their newsletters and websites, we have also posted advertisements, and also for eligible persons and bodies, we have also sent out letters to call for registration. So focusing on functional constituencies registration, we have done work. Mr. Chang Hua-feng, if you think that there are bodies or areas where we can do more focused work for functional constituencies, we would be happy to receive such information from you so that we can go back and consider them. From the government's paper, Mr. Chair, for this year's register for direct election for the districts, it is 186,000 more. However, there are 3,000 plus less from the functional constituencies registration. So I would like to know why is that and what is this year's situation. Yes, if you can pay attention to that. Yes. Wang Yongman. Goodness. The functional constituencies. What voters do you need? What registration do you need? There are no contestants usually for functional constituencies. It's ridiculous that you should raise this, but I'll not go into a discussion with you on this. No, this is a campaign, and we're only talking about just over $10 million. And as we all know, 18 to 20 years of age, people the registration rate is low. So what are you going to do to raise the registration rate of young people? There are a number of reasons. They're not confident of the LegCo, the government. They are dispassionate about the political system. Somebody mentioned just now media and social media and internet platforms. Well, I can tell you, people skip it, even for LegCo videos. And on Google, for instance, yours is an advertisement. People skip it. So for the mainstream media, I'm sure they'll provide this free of charge. For social media, if you're going to spend money to do it, then you have to think about the content. Make a video. Sometimes on Facebook, we have excellent videos. Thailand, for instance, they have some excellent ads. Or the sharing is numerous because people no longer notice what they're promoting, because advertising itself is very persuasive. I recently saw another ad. The Taipei mayor, An, he had a 6-minute ad, and it was obviously an ad, and he said that this is about self-reflection, and people look at it. He was reflecting as to where he failed and what he said wrong. It was so touching. But it's political propaganda, obviously, and the smart people would know, would see through it. So what I'm saying is that, so for something so political, a short film, so many people see it, it's because of its very good packaging. You understand? So for encouraging people to register as voters, you're very square. Look at the basic law promotion videos. Who would want to see them? If you want to target young people, you have to speak their language. And you're speaking your language. Hey, you're young, Mr. Chan. And if you adopt the old style language, you know, what efficacy will there be? Young people don't correspond. I'm in my 60s. I can talk to the young, not you. So you have to think about the content if you want to promote to them. And another point, which is a revisitation on my part, and that is mandatory registration. Well, Singapore, Australia, Switzerland, they do it on a mandatory basis. And the government has no expenses put into it, no fear of vote rigging. Make it mandatory so that the people of Hong Kong are encouraged and participating in the political system and they're ready to speak. Even in Taiwan, it is almost mandatory. That is to say, they do not have to register. As long as they have the account, the residence account in their place of residence, all they have to do is to brandish or produce their ID card and be able to vote. Wish you well.
Thank you, Chair. Members talked about the VR campaign. Well, it's been clearly pointed out that the registration rate among the young has been lower. Perhaps we should choose the right channels and the right media. Like what Mr. Ray Chen has said, we need to be sure about the right tool and we have to be careful about the content. A lot has been said about the funding for VR. It is just a small amount, just $12 million. It seems to show that there is a lack of determination on the part of the government. Every year after April, district councils will get funding from the government, and we usually have a particular theme, say for example, family harmony. If the government would like to raise the registration rate among the young, I think the HAD can say that this should be one of the themes for application of funding. So the different district councils can find their own ways to publicize the message. Now come to my question. For the registration form, understand that there is a space for you to provide your email address. But then I've been told by the residents that they have given their email address, but perhaps as a result of that, they don't get their our publicity materials by post. So just want to clarify with you whether the fact that you give your email address would deny you of receiving the publicity materials by mail. Mr. Lee, currently in the application form, the applicant may give his email address. It says that it will be given to the candidates for the dissemination of electoral materials. Now, say for example, if a candidate has put in his application, then addresses of electors in the register will be given to the candidates plus the email address. No, I don't think that's the case. If an elector has given an email address, then we don't get the elector's address in the form of a mailing label. Well, we have got a CD-ROM for the candidates. It's a database for the addresses. For the address label, it is different because the disk will carry the email addresses as well. For the address labels, they are labels for addresses of electors who haven't given an email address. We want to be environmentally friendly. We hope that more publicity work will be carried out via the internet. Now, for the address labels, they are not a statutory requirement under the law. We are just doing it on an administrative basis. So we want to be green, and in fact, candidates are not prevented from producing their own address labels. They can send out the publicity materials. Would it be regarded as an opting out? Your time limit has been exceeded. Please direct your question to the chair of the DP because she would like to be environmentally friendly. I remember it clearly. I would like to extend the meeting till 4:45. Three members would like to ask questions. Please be mindful of the time limit. Mr. Chairman, for the last item, we talked about the enhancement of the voter registration system. We hope that there will be resources to implement the enhancement measures. Please don't tell us that you haven't got the money to do so. I am all for more checking and more random checking, and we should remind the electors to be accurate in their information. Now, it is said that we should promote voter registration. Yes, it is good, but please don't rush to the homes for the elderly to register for the elderly. So, Undersecretary, please pay attention to this, otherwise it will become a serious problem. And then for Mr. Christopher Cheng, he said that we have got a reduction of 3,000 FC voters. Well, do you know that during the last election, 16 FC members were elected ipso facto? So there was no motivation on the part of the voters to get registered. So Mr. Cheng and other FC members, well, there's a lack of competition. There are no choices. Members were elected uncontested. So please don't spare resources and time on those things. I think it's better for us to channel our energy on having universal suffrage and the elimination of the small circle elections. He has to answer my questions. We'll make sure that there will be adequate resources to implement our measures. Mr. Leung Kwok Hong, well, it is simple. Small circle is better than a large circle, no circle is better than small circle. For those elected uncontested, there wasn't even a small circle. almost a half of the seats have been about half of the members were returned without going through an election. So please ask this question. How come that the voters were not interested in exercising their voting right? Now, for small circle electorates, it's a matter of 200,000 electors only. This is the case for the returning of the CE. Now, for the DC2 constituency, the weight of a voter is smaller, much smaller, because we are talking about 1 million votes. So for the small circle elections, a small number of people monopolize all the powers. So it is not convincing. For small circle elections, they don't just happen in LC elections. Now, we have got the same electorates to elect the CE. The difference is that for the CE, it's different. We are talking about an electorate of 1,200 electors, and everybody will go to the polling station. It will be a waste of time. It is universal but unequal. For the one-man, two-vote system, the two votes carry different weight and very different. So something is black, you can't call it white. Therefore, people have lost interest in voting. Secondly, if you encourage people to go to the polling station, Mr. Chen, please look in my direction. Now, for CY Leung, if you ask CY Leung to go to the mainstream media and let him boast of his own achievements, then I'm sure people will try to kick him out of the office. If he tries to say that he has good governance, there's harmony, etc., then he will attract a good rating. So if we talk a lot about having a very decent life under the rule of 6H9, then it will be very attractive. Even for President Obama, there used to be a very famous video clip with a length of 4.5 minutes that's entitled to change. So ask CY Leung to come out, say that he would like to be given 5 more years. I'm sure many more people will turn out to register. The last, Mr. Lee, Mr. Chairman, regarding the publicity involved in VR. I think in the past, there was only one single message: get registered so as to discharge your civic responsibility. This is important. However, I think other messages could have been added. Say, for example, you have got the responsibility to change your residential address. Tell them how they can do this, and then tell people that before the register is finalized, electors can find out whether the particulars are still correct. Though the APIs may be too short to contain so many messages, I think such information is important. Other than getting registered for the first time, it is also important to change the particulars when there is already a change. For those who haven't been registered, I think all of them should be encouraged to register rather than just targeting at the newly qualified electors. So you shouldn't just focus on a particular age group, as everybody should be encouraged to be registered. Now come to my third point. For your consultation document, you talk about shortening the time available to change one's address. If you want to do this, you need to spend more time on this. We have got many more problematic cases in the latest round, probably due to lack of publicity. Few people would have expected that their addresses could have been changed by others. So for your application form, maybe it's a good idea to ask for the existing address as well as the new address, and then a bank procedure after transaction has been completed, give him a phone call or a message. I think such ideas could be and should be implemented. Are you going to do so? Mr. Chen, basically, I agree with all that has been said by Mr. Lee. When I gave my opening remarks, I have already highlighted a few points, and that's also in line with what Ms. Lee is saying. For the statutory deadline for making changes to the particulars, if this is to be advanced, then it means that it will be one of the important messages to be publicized. And then for the online voter information inquiry system as well as the REO hotline, surely we can publicize the information more so the electors can make use of such channels to check their status. And we will emphasize the importance of providing true and accurate information. And if somebody has moved house, then he will be advised to provide the most up-to-date address to the REO. All such will be brought out in our VR campaign. I think the penalty would be important. It is an honest system. So if we need to tell them about the dire consequences of giving false information. So if it is having a strong enough deterrent effect, then no one would try to break the law. I think time is up to end the meeting. So item 5, AOB, if there isn't anything under AOB, meeting is adjourned. Date of next meeting, the 18th of January at 2:30 p.m. Thank you.